Have two breakdowns here from Kevin Gastola, who shadowproofed The Dissenter, previous guest of Conflicts of Interest, is one of the most just consistent and detailed observers and reporters of Assange's extradition case. And so his breakdowns have been absolutely essential. If you're not already, follow him on Twitter. He does Twitter threads anytime there's any Assange stuff going on in court. That's really invaluable. It's the next best experience to actually being there watching yourself. So it's really great to check those out. But then he writes up great articles. And so this first one he has was from day one of the appeal hearing, and day one was the day where the UK their crown prosecutor, who is acting on behalf and represents the United States government, so the UK government is working with the US government to make the case in UK court to get Assange extradited to the United States. And the guy's name is James Lewis. Now, what they are arguing is that I guess something like more of a district judge, Vanessa Bretzer, ruled initially that while Assange did violate the law and terrible ruling on First Amendment grounds, absolutely atrocious what she did, ended up ruling against the extradition because of Assange's mental health. It would make it likely that he would involuntarily commit suicide because of the horrific conditions of the American prisons. And so that was her initial ruling. And what the U.S. and through the Crown Prosecutor is doing here is arguing that the judge ruled incorrectly. And this is because she put too much weight, or at least in part, what she did incorrectly is she put too much weight on one of the psychiatrists for the defense, and I'll break down kind of his testimony in that later. But the U.S. through the Crown Prosecutor is also arguing here that they should have been given an opportunity by Judge Bretzer to, what, you know, when she thought, oh, the prison sentences are too tough, she should have came to them and said, hey, can you do anything to make it so I could extradite Assange? And they say, oh, well, you know, we'll make these guarantees so you feel comfortable that he won't kill himself. Now, we'll get into all this a little bit more. Just a couple notes on the hearing itself. Initially, I believe this is from Edward Fitzgerald, who's Assange's, I think, main like defense attorney, says that Assange will not be attending because he's not feeling well due to his medication. Not sure what medication they have him on. Just from my personal experience working in the U.S. mental health field with people who were in and out of prison, one of the really tough things if you have mental health is prisons really restrict the kinds of medications that you could take. And so let's say you're on an antipsychotic that works really well for you. Well, that prison might say, yeah, well, we don't allow people to take that antipsychotic here. And so you have to switch to maybe something that's less effective, has different side effects. These are really tough changes that people often have to go through in prison. Also, just like the kinds of anti-anxiety meds or sleeping meds that could be offered to somebody in prison, at least in the U.S., are very limited, and it's typically not the very effective ones that they allow into the prisons. And so my guess is that it's generally similar in the U.K., and that Assange could be getting, you know, not be getting the medication he needs because of the court system. Now, I also understand that Assange has some kind of autoimmune disorder, and while he was in the Ecuadorian embassy, consumed quite a bit of bone broth to help with that, you know, very high nutrient. And of course, just like, you know, with medication, the nutrition of meals in prison is fairly limited to really poor. And so that could be just other parts of what's going on here. But anyways, that was what the I believe it's somebody on Assange's side said. Now, then Assange shows up to court about an hour later and people could see him. He says he doesn't look well. Looks, I don't know if aloof is the right word, but just like just maybe isn't feeling well enough to like really comprehend what's going on. So he has maybe his hand on his face, you know, kind of just resting there and stuff like that. Now, his partner, Stella Morse, the mother of his children, said that originally he was denied, by the court to attend. Now, another thing is, and I know this was the case with his initial trial for his extradition, I'm sure it's the case here as well, that because he's held in the Belmarsh prison in the UK, which is sometimes referred to the UK's Gitmo, not only because of they hold their terrorists there, but also because of the harsh treatments in the prison. Now, maybe it would be better to call it like the UK's like Florence ADX, which is a horrific prison. But you had to go through strip searches, right? Like somebody has to see and potentially, you know, touch your genitalia at any time you come and go from the prison, maybe even at times your cell. And so that's quite intrusive, quite humiliating, hard things to go through. And, that may explain part of the reason I'm not wanting to be at all these hearings, not, feeling well, is just, having like the anxiety and the knowing that this is going to happen to you, this unfair, inhumane treatment has to be absolutely horrific. One thing that Kevin Gustola noted is that there were, in general, more mainstream journalists actually attending via the video feed. He highlighted Michael Iskoff, who recently reported, people say he broke the story. That's not really true, but at least he broke into the mainstream, the reporting that the CIA was planning in part to assassinate Julian Assange. So it's, I guess, not surprising to me that Iskoff was on this, especially because his reporting does come up. I think that's mostly the on day two, so we'll get into that in a few minutes. So as I kind of said before, the two overall things, the two clusters, I think there's a total of like kind of five baskets of appeal here, but kind of the two groups of them would be that they should have been consulted and that they were now offering a guarantee that Julian Assange would not face two things: special administration measures, SAMs, or ADX Florence, which is basically SAMs all the time. This is 23 and a half hours a day in your cell. This is really not being able to communicate with anybody, all of your communications monitored, no physical interaction, really all this kind of absolutely terrible stuff, the absolute inhumane, torturous U.S. prison conditions, which is, essentially being in solitary all the time for the rest of your life. So they're saying they're guaranteeing that they're not going to do this, which is completely absurd. If the UK extradites Assange, the US would absolutely put him in any of these facilities, even, for whatever guarantees, even if it's not any concern that Assange is going to do anything. Now, here's my concern. I think this is way too technical of an argument. Whether he's in SAMS or ADX Florence, at any prison he goes to, they could just put him in solitary confinement indefinitely, or just with like COVID protocols and quarantines and all that, they could just so heavily restrict where he's able to do and go and how many people he could, see, what kind of prison population that he's in. I imagine it could be absolutely horrific. Now, one thing the U.S. has also floated was once he was convicted, he would be able to serve out the rest of his sentence in Australia, but I'm not all that certain that that would put Assange in any better of a situation. We see Australia is very tight, a very central player in the U.S. empire, and so if the U.S. wants to apply some pressure on Australia to put Assange in horrific prison conditions, I wouldn't really be surprised by that. So that's one real issue. I think the Assange team did a pretty good job. It seems like they, just kind of said that this is nonsense and that you can't, have the idea that you could just guarantee, the U.S. could guarantee and you could trust that. And then the other thing that they wanted to really object was that Judge Feretzer put too much weight on the expert testimony of the Assange psychiatrist Kopelman, who said there was a very high risk Assange would commit suicide if he went to the United States, not because of some like kind of narcissism or something like that, but rather because putting somebody on the autism spectrum as Julian Assange is, somebody who's depressed, somebody who has all these issues, as Assange has, in the U.S. prison system, the just likeliness that somebody is going to involuntarily commit suicide because their life is so terrible and miserable and torturous, and you will do anything to escape the, you know, purposelessness. You know, they're not torturing him for information. They're just doing it to make him feel absolutely terrible. By doing that, it is making somebody likely to kill themselves. And that was essentially his argument. Now, the main crux of this is that in his initial report, Kopelman didn't include that Julian Assange had a romantic relationship with Stella Morris, somebody on his legal team, and that he had fathered two children, right, through Stella Morris. And there's several problems with making this argument. One, the U.S. side already knew it. They had spied on Assange in the Ecuadorian embassy for years. And while, you know, maybe they afforded themselves some privacy by pitching a tent in, you know, the Ecuadorian embassy, what do you think? What did the CIA couldn't put together that Assange was going into a tent with a woman, and then 9 months later she was coming around the embassy pregnant, and you know, the her children were coming, and Assange was, I'm sure, affectionate with his children. You know, all this stuff had to be very obvious for the level of surveillance that the CIA had through UC Global in the Ecuadorian embassy. And so it's just stupid to make this argument, right? It's just saying that, oh, you know, I guess they're trying to maybe say it shows some kind of bias that Kopelman has for Assange. Now, again, through my experience working in mental health, and again, this is in the U.S., so maybe there's a little bit of a difference here. You know, psychiatrists would have discretion on what kind of information they need to disclose to a court, and people have a right to privacy to what they disclose to their psychiatrist. And so it's not obvious that a psychiatrist would absolutely have to disclose this kind of thing, especially as we see through the reporting originally, like through the Gray Zone and Foreign Press, and then of course through Yahoo and Michael Iskov more recently, that there was a threat to the life of Julian Assange and people around him. And so it isn't completely like absurd that, you know, he would have some reservations here. Also, if you're just assessing the risk that Julian Assange would commit suicide in a U.S. prison, it doesn't necessarily, I think, make a clear impact one way or the other whether this would make him more or less likely to kill himself. It could actually be, you know, being separated, knowing he's not going to get to see his children as their formative years, as they grow up, at the very least, if not forever, you know, maybe actually a motivating, make it more likely that he kills himself. And so from that perspective, it really doesn't, you know, change that he could be on the autism spectrum or not. Maybe there's some underlying stereotyping here, stigma towards people on the autism spectrum, that, you know, somehow they couldn't feel love and affection and it wouldn't hurt them to be away from their family or something like that, which of course is absolute garbage and untrue. Also, you know, one thing to bring up on that, being somebody who was a part of the mental health community and worked in the field for 7 years, and you know, I'm aware of all these organizations, and they advocate for people in the United States who have autism, you know, spectrum disorder, and who are put in all kinds of unfair conditions. You know, this seems like American with, you know, disabilities issue, NAMI or autism speech or something like that, may want to weigh in here and say, like, hey, it's not right to put somebody with these conditions in these places, because it's even more torturous than it would be for somebody who doesn't have these developmental disabilities, something that you are born with. It's simply that your brain is wired differently. And, that's definitely something that I think should be considered. And, you know, along with like First Amendment type groups, you would hope that eventually at some point these groups do come to the aid of Julian Assange, as now he is one of the most prominent people in the world on the autism spectrum. That's definitely something to consider. One of the most influential people in the history of journalism, and certainly one of the most influential people in this century, is on the autism spectrum. There, you know, something very interesting about that, but yet there's really no activism or support from Assange coming at all from that community, and maybe some of that should really start to be considered. So anyways, That is, I guess that's like the main part of their argument. Now, one important thing that happens that Kevin Gastola outlines in his article is actually Kopelman wasn't sure what to do and wanted to consult with a legal team, like, hey, how actually do I handle this situation? Because it's not clear if I need to incorporate this or not. And I could say that at least as like a psychiatric team, like these are questions that, you know, that would be discussed in team meetings. Like, what would we have to discuss? Disclose in court about our client, because you know, what is and isn't relevant. What, you know, did you learn from the privileged relationship that you have with this person as a psychiatrist? They also point out that Assange disclosed, I believe, in 2020 to the U.S. Expert psychiatrist that he did have two children, and also that this was filed, I guess, in early 2020, February 2020, as a part of Assange's seeking bail to be released on bail, having close family nearby, as you know, having kids and stuff like that keeps people from fleeing bail. So that's like a part of something that you can include if you're seeking bail, you know, to be able to bail yourself out of jail, right? But that wasn't granted. So the US definitely knew this is a completely irrelevant argument, but yet is something that they're going to try to use, because what they want is the, I guess, high court to reevaluate the decision that Judge Mark Bretzer made. But rather than placing a lot of weight on the testimony of Kopelman, they say not to discard him completely, but to put zero weight on what he said. So essentially, discard it completely. Now, day two was the response from the Assange team, and I got Gastola's notes. Our article up here. It seems that the Assange team took a lot of time to talk about the Yahoo article, and I understand why the so. On this show, when we initially talked about this article, I was like, you know, this is the deep state reporting on something that had already been well covered and known in the independent media. But what they were doing was including a whole bunch of Russiagate propaganda wrapped up in it, right? And so, you know, I don't like that article. However, I understand and appreciate what the Assange legal team is doing by using this so heavily, because when you're talking about mainstream reporters like Michael Iskov, mainstream sources like Yahoo News, it's a lot harder for the judge to just go, oh, what's the gray zone? You know, and then the other side to go, well, you know, there's claims of like anti-Semitism or supporting Russia or supporting Putin from the gray zone, and all the you know, prosecution would just line up all those smears, and they can't even do that with the Yahoo article. So I think it was powerful to bring it up, although I'm not sure how much of an impact it really has on the arguments at hand, but maybe that's me misunderstanding the UK legal system somehow. Something I think more important that the defense brought up and highlighted was the CMUs that the United States have. These are communication management units, and this is where Daniel Hale currently is. And so Gastola actually has this great article that I ran as the spotlight at antiwar.com one day last week called "Imprisoning Drone Whistleblower in Isolation Unit May Jeopardize U.S. Appeal in Assange Extradition Case," where Gastola goes through where Hale is being kept. I think it's in Marion, Illinois, in this prison where essentially he can't have any communication. No, like, you know, his mom comes to see him, right? His mama comes. She can't give him a hug. He calls his mama. He can only have 2 15-minute calls a week, and they have to be scheduled ahead of time, and there has to be an FBI agent listening in on the call. And let's say that FBI agent just either wants to be a dick on that day or actually like forgets about it or whatever, then his call is canceled. And so that's the communications management unit. And this is, you know, something that Assange could face in the United States. Now, just think about how stupid this is in the case of Daniel Hale, right? This is a guy who leaked these documents, what, 5-6 years before there was ever a trial against him, before he was ever put in prison. He was out on bail for a good chunk of the time before he was actually sentenced and sent to jail. And when he was, you know, when his bail was rejected, it's because, you know, some psychiatrist narked and said that he was worried Hale was going to take his own life, not actually that Hale was in any way gonna do anything that would require his communications to be monitored. And so this is just absurd and stupid that you have Hale in this, and it's clearly vindictive, just like having the Vault 7, the likely Vault 7 leaker in ADF Florence. This is just vindictive, and it shows the way the U.S. Bureau of Prisons will operate and treat Julian Assange should he be extradited to the United States. So I think Gastola's argument here and what he points out is really important. And you know, poor Daniel Hale, who's in these terrible conditions. But if him being in that condition could help make an argument for Julian Assange, you know, we should absolutely do that. And at the same time, you know, try to get Daniel Hale out of those horrific conditions himself. I believe, like, if you're in that condition too, like, if you send Daniel Hale a letter or something, the FBI is reading everything that you send, and you know, they have complete discretion on whether they give him that information or not. And so, you know, just treating people, like, in absolutely horrific ways. And again, Daniel Hale is somebody who they let make a documentary about drones after he blew the whistle on the drone program, and then years after that is when they actually go and prosecute him, and now they throw him in communications management unit. So I think that's pretty important. Assange's team does a good job, you know, kind of explaining why the judge made the decisions that she made and everything like that. And actually that while the U.S. and other experts, psychiatrists that were brought up in relation to Assange's extradition case also found that he had depression and all these other kind of mental health stuff going on. I'm not sure if they actually conclude he was on the autism spectrum, but it's not like they were like, oh, he's faking it or something like that. So that's another reason to really give a lot of credit to the Kopelman testimony. So one last thing I want to do before I move on from Assange is talk about Caitlin Johnstone's great article titled From Press Freedom to Prison Systems, Everything Assange Touches Gets Illuminated. And you know, I'm not going to go through and break down the whole article. I already spent a little bit more time than I planned on this today. But what she's, you know, talking about is that Assange is such an important figure that whether it's talking about journalism and explaining how the First Amendment works and protects everyone who's publishing information, not just ever the government happens to label as a journalist, whoever's privileged enough to work at CNN. No, we can all be journalists. I'm a journalist, and if somebody gives me information, I'm allowed to report on that. The U.S. government can't claim that, oh no, conflicts of interest isn't CNN, and so therefore Kyle Anzalone doesn't have a First Amendment. I have a First Amendment, Julian Assange has a First Amendment, and also now he's shining a light on prison conditions. You know, so many more people are talking about SAMs that have existed forever, the Communications Management Unit, ADF Florence, and the horrific way people are treated in U.S. prisons, especially people with mental health issues. If it wasn't for, you know, Assange going through what he's going through, it wouldn't be talked about so much. And so, you know, while Assange is suffering, there's not really good coming from it, but maybe shining a light on some problems that really need to be discussed, and then maybe we could make some good happen from there. Now let's talk about